still getting over the jet lag, but very happy to be here. Like I said, I come from a very small community, which is in the northern part by the Rocky Mountains, on the east side of the Rocky Mountains. A small Cree community where I'm actually the first generation to not attend the mission schools. Like many people here on this panel, many of our families went to mission schools, and my dad was actually hidden for the first, just under the first decade of his life, from the Indian agent that would come into our communities and take the children. And so they eventually went to a day school, and we've heard many horrible stories from what our communities and our families have experienced from colonial policy that impacted Indigenous communities right across Canada, as well as Indigenous communities here. And so on top of that, after facing these types of genocidal policies, our communities are really reeling in the crisis and experiencing post-traumatic stress syndrome, intergenerational trauma. So, you know, what we're also experiencing is a new form of colonialism in the form of resource extraction. And since I was born, there's actually been logging, conventional oil and gas, tar sands, fracking, and extreme. So if you haven't heard of tar sands, I think maybe most people have at this point, hopefully, but it's one of the most extreme forms of extracting oil from the earth. And the dirtiest form, and also the most carbon intensive form. And so that's where I was born into. And so that's what I've seen, you know, as a young child going in the horse and wagon with my grandparents and seeing the beauty and the pristine of the boreal forest, which is actually the northern lungs of Mother Earth, which holds in a lot of the carbon. And now Canada is number one in deforestation because of the tar sands and basically uplifting the boreal, which is one of the last remaining intact forests in the world. And we've surpassed now the Amazon in deforestation. So it's been a pretty intense thing to see the land and the water and the air changing drastically within my lifetime. And what we've experienced on top of that is actually oil spills as well, from the pipelines that are kind of crisscrossing 400,000 kilometers of pipeline that crisscrosses Alberta. And just to finish into that, and I want to actually talk a bit more about renewables, but to understand what we are also dealing with in terms of why we're transitioning to renewable energy in our communities. And I know Chief Planis will talk about this, who's a big inspiration from where I come from, is because with this type of resource extraction, communities are on the front lines of resource extraction, also on the front lines of climate change. And that's why what we call in North America, and it's probably maybe called here, but just transition. What does a just transition look like? Because if communities are just transitioning, but a lot of communities are being left behind that have experienced the brunt of environmental degradation and climate change, then I don't really see justice in that transition that we're all trying to build here in this room. And so what we decided to do after a massive oil spill impacted our homeland, which was one of the biggest in Alberta's and Canada's history, was to start that transition to renewable energy. And so I started researching and did my master's in Indigenous governance and focused on renewable energy and what that looks like in First Nation communities. And with that, it was a project that actually now powers our health center. It's a 20.8 kilowatt solar project that powers our local health center, and it's one of the largest top-of-home mount systems now in our region. And it's a beacon, really, of light for people, because a lot of people at that point, if you think about rural communities, have never seen solar panels. So my auntie, who's in her 70s, she said, "Oh, you know, I've never seen these before, and I thought I would only see them in my lifetime on TV." And so, you know, when we brought them into the community, it was really exciting to, you know, hold a solar feast and to have a ribbon cutting ceremony to actually be powered by renewables. And this gives the young people an ability to see that the future does not have to be from destroying our homelands and resource extraction and potentially, you know, a catastrophic climate crisis that we're all facing as a human race. And so that's why for us, renewable energy is quite exciting to utilize this type of technology, which is actually much more in line with Indigenous values and philosophy, because it's regenerative and it's much more in reciprocity with our natural laws and our natural environment, as opposed to which is resource extraction, which is an extractive way of living. So that's all I'm going to say